my husband isn't here, so I'm going to embarrass him by reading an essay called Interstates that published in the American Scholar a few years ago. And it's about my marriage, my interracial marriage, and it's a journey. So let me just take you through the first little beats of this. John, my parents, and I are heading south on Route 55 from Nashville to Hazelhurst, Mississippi. He is driving. My father rides shotgun. I sit in the back with my mother, holding my breath. The entire car is silent. All four of us are still as stones. We have to pull over, John says. It is a mid-morning in July. I try to focus on passing cars. There's a gas station a few miles up, my father says evenly. He shifts in his seat. The front left tire is flat. John and I have been engaged for several months at this point in my life story. This is not his first visit to Nashville, but it is his first visit to Mississippi, where he will meet my extended family, my mother's mother, sisters, cousins, and nieces. The car belongs to my father, who has entrusted the wheel to John as a symbol of his acquiescence to the new order of things, namely John's having supplanted him as the man in my life. But it was only a gesture. When he gave John control of the car, my father did not anticipate that John would actually exercise the authority to take us on a new course. But he does. He pulls over right there on the shoulder of the interstate, somewhere between Memphis and Jackson. Within minutes, John is underneath the car while my parents and I stand in a grassy depression near him. I feel pride as I watch my fiancé's strong, tan arms move in confident, rhythmic silence as he replaces a spent tire with a spare that is, distressingly, nearly flat itself. And I ache for my father, who shifts quickly from side to side, wordlessly hurrying John. There we stand, my black family, as vulnerable as an open window. We are bound by history and helplessness. I focus on John, willing his whiteness and masculine strength toward us, imagining these qualities shielding us from harm, like armor. The eyes of white men in jeans and work boots travel from John to me to my parents when we arrive at the nearest gas station, which is not the one my father mentioned. He and my mother stay in the car while John, dirty and sweaty, strides into the store. I follow him, carrying a small, impractical purse and decked out in oversized sunglasses. We buy water, fill the tank, and then we're back on the road. My mother, in a voice sugared with amusement and pride, will tell this story to many people for many years to come. It is a story about how a black family used to do things one way, and then a brand new white man came into their lives, and nothing was ever the same. My father is a creature of habit, someone who holds tradition in high regard. The reason for his reluctance to stop before we reached the gas station, however, had nothing to do with habit or tradition. Instead, it had to do with history, both small and large. His preferred gas station had proven to be an hospitable place over the years. Several times he had received service there without incident, something no black person traveling through the South has ever taken for granted. When my father arrived in Nashville to attend Fisk University in the 1950s, a black body had to travel along known routes, relying upon the experiences of other black people. For many years, a guide called the Green Book informed black travelers of places where it was possible for them to sleep and eat. It was a map of a modern underground railroad. Black bodies out of place would likely encounter insults to their dignity or worse. The Green Book ceased publication in 1966, but to this day, there are cities and towns in this country in which the perils inherent and traveling black have not subsided. John was not ignorant of the root of my father's anxiety, but the danger presented by the flat tire took precedence over any other type of danger. Somewhere between the clarity of his focus and the complexity of my father's anxiety, perhaps, lies the difference between living black and living white in America. That there is a difference is indisputable. How deep the difference runs is impossible to ascertain. I see the difference. Mostly, I despise it. But my belief that difference can engender pleasure as well as pain made it possible for me to marry a white man.